I'm just going to provide just a little bit of an overview and context about the Prescription Drug User Fee Act, what it is, why it exists. And then we have a really expert panel to provide a little more information about it through the different lenses of some of the stakeholders who really help reflect some of the needs of the community into the user fee negotiations. So just first, what is PDUFA? And as we know, we all love acronyms here in Washington. So PDUFA was first passed into law in 1992, and it's a law that helps to supplement FDA's resources through what are called user fees. And these are fees that are paid by the pharmaceutical industry companies. So these are not taxes that are paid by you and me and by Americans. These are biopharmaceutical sponsors pay these fees to help support critical resources at the FDA that addressed needs that were identified by stakeholders, including patient groups, industry partners, and others. And I'll talk in a moment about what some of those needs were and what the resources are that they provide. And the fees are paid at two different time points. One is there's an application fee, and that's paid when a therapeutic is in development. So either when the NDA or the BLA is submitted, and then there's a program fee. And so that's post-approval. So at two different time points, a sponsor will pay a fee. And then in turn, FDA sets a target review timeline. And so many of us have heard the terms PDUFA dates. And oftentimes it's a term a lot of our rare disease patient communities focus on when there is a PDUFA date set for when we anticipate there's going to be an announcement around whether or not a product is approved. And that comes out of this, the Prescription Drug User Fee Act. And what went into that law initially and every time it's reauthorized. And that timeline is 10 months for a standard review and 6 months for a priority review. The next slide. So why PDUFA in the first place? Why in 1992? And why do we every 5 years go to the trouble to talk about it, look at what additional resources or infrastructure could be enhanced? So it was created as a way to really look at what the resource gaps were at the FDA and what additional capacity could be brought to bear within the agency. As many of us know, because we've been talking about additional ways to address bottlenecks at the agency, there were even more significant regulatory bottlenecks within the agency. And the review timelines were drastically different than they are now. So prior to PDUFA, more than 70% of new medications were first approved outside of the United States. So I just want people to pause and think about what that means for a moment. And on average, it took FDA 27 months to review a new drug. So if you think about the impact that that has on our rare disease community, if the review timeline was so long. And then by 2012, so the impact, the benefit of PDUFA, an average FDA review timeline was 13.3 months. And so I think it's important to know that the PDUFA date is a suggestion. So when on the previous slide, I talked about those PDUFA timelines, that those are targets, those are aspirational, and FDA works really hard to meet those, but that's not a requirement. And so that really this, the PDUFA language and the PDUFA Act has really done a really great job of helping to bring additional resources into the agency, shorten those timelines. And on that last bullet point, you'll see that now more than 78% of medications are first approved in the United States, meaning it has incentivized therapy development and brought sponsors to conducting trials here in the US. So that's really important. And I expect maybe our partners from Bio and Pharma who are on with us today may talk about that. Okay, next slide. Okay, so PDUFA has been renewed 5 times, and I'm not gonna take us through each of the iterations, although those who are on this panel may talk a little bit about highlights in each one. But we are now moving into the PDUFA 7 cycle, And we are right now living in PDUFA 6, if you will. So PDUFA 6 was passed in 2017, and many of us in the community were really a part of those discussions and the public workshops that FDA convened to understand what were the priorities of the patient community as they discussed what would be contained within PDUFA 6. PDUFA 6 expires on September 30th, 2022. And so those discussions around what will go into PDUFA 7 are starting now. And so what was really noteworthy within PDUFA 6 was this term that many of us now use very commonly, it's commonplace, it's PFDD, or patient-focused drug development. And again, that was baked into PDUFA 6, but before then, we never used that term. It actually was, for the first time, was used in PDUFA 6, and it's now codified as a part of FDA's mission. Also, real-world evidence and clinical trial innovations were very significant elements of PDUFA 6. Next slide. So the process, and again, I suspect our panelists will take us through, so this is, again, just for some context, but I think it's really important since I know many on this call today are members of the patient community. I think it's important that patient community members feel empowered to be a part of this process. So FDA Invite has already put out a call to non-industry stakeholders. So that includes advocacy groups, members of the patient community, healthcare professionals, anyone who's interested in participating in the PDUFA consultation meetings have to indicate their interest by August 17th. And that information is available on our website. So if you don't know where to find that, you can find it on FDA's website, but we've also made that information available on our website as to how it indicate your interest. The first public workshop, so FDA convenes public workshops as a part of the PDUFA discussions. The first one's being held next week, which is why we're talking about this today. And they have monthly periodic consultation meetings that go alongside their negotiations. And so that's, again, another really important part of the process. That said, there are key stakeholders that FDA sits down with and negotiates the PDUFA agreement with, and what yields from that is a commitment letter. And those stakeholders include trade associations and a representative from the patient community. And those trade associations and National Health Council are on with us today to talk more about the process and PDUFA through their lens. And I cannot underscore enough the importance of the role that those organizations play and our gratitude to those organizations for the work that they've done on behalf of our communities over the years.
Just a quick note on the National Health Council, for those of you who aren't familiar with us, we were founded in 1920 as a trade association for patient advocacy organizations. So we picked one heck of a year to celebrate our 100th anniversary. What makes us unique is in the 1960s, we opened up membership to a broad stakeholder community. So in membership currently, we have representatives from the provider, family caregiving, insurance, biopharmaceutical, device, diagnostic, really the entire healthcare ecosystem. And we work together to provide a united voice for people with chronic diseases and disabilities. We have the patient groups are still our core constituency who control our governments and policymaking process, but we hear from a wide range of perspectives as we work to advocate on Capitol Hill and with the administration. If we go to the next slide, want to talk a little bit about kind of what our priorities are for PDUFA 7, but first want to kind of level set on some of the recent successes that the patient community has had. And I'll say that, you know, these things did not come by accident. If you take one thing away from this session today, it's the importance of engaging in the process. You know, starting with the public workshop next week and then participating in the regular stakeholder meetings are a really, really impactful way to ensure that the patient voice is heard in the process. And we've done it to great success in recent iterations and hope to do so in PDUFA 7 as well. And you know, at least next week and probably the next couple will be done virtually. So for those of you who may be on the West Coast or outside of the DC area, might be easier to participate this time around as well. So going back a few iterations to PDUFA 5, this was really the first time that we saw a whole host of regulatory science improvements added. I think FDA has done a really good job of working with industry since the beginning of PDUFA to speed up the timelines and have really, as we heard earlier, done a great job of getting new products onto the market through the program. But because they did such a great job of that, they were able to kind of allocate some resources to a lot of great improvements as well. Most notably, Annie mentioned the patient-focused drug development program. We think this is one of the most transformational initiatives we've ever seen out of the FDA, and know that there's good opportunities to keep moving that forward. If we go to the next slide, PDUFA 6, we saw a lot of iterations on top of PDUFA 5. So not only did they start with the PFDD meetings that I know a lot of people on the call have either hosted or participated in, but under the current PDUFA, they're also working to develop guidances for industry and other stakeholders to know how better to know how to better incorporate, capture, and incorporate the patient perspective into their work. And you know, our goal is, and our hope is, that as they roll out the rest of the series of guidances, they just finalized the first one last month, and we'll be rolling out more over the next year or two. That once those guidances are done, it'll give a lot of important clarity for industry to know not only the importance of patient engagement to the agency, but also ways of really doing a better job of incorporating the patient voice. If we go to the next slide. So as we think about PDUFA 7, a lot of what we want to do is similar to how we saw PDUFA 5 go from the PFDD meetings to the guidances in 6. What are some of those next steps that can really help better incorporate the patient perspective into drug development and review? So if we go to the next slide. You heard from Danielle a bit on the use of digital tools. We had already seen industry really start to move in this direction, really as a way to decrease clinical trial participation burden and really enable them to reach a broader, more diverse, and more representative patient population. We already saw this happening, but in the world of COVID, I think we've seen a huge expansion of it as well out of necessity. So there's a lot of learnings that have been coming over the last few years and certainly over the last few months on how we can better deploy digital tools such as wearables, trackables, things of that nature to be an input into the clinical trial process. The one thing that we're still kind of trying to learn a little bit more about is how can we do a better job. I think one area that we would like to see within the National Health Council is more of an effort to engage patients in the deployment of these tools. How can we make sure that they're done in a way that's least burdensome for patients and really helps industry capture the data that they need? So one thing that we would like to see in PDUFA 7 would be some sort of pilot program that helps fund industry to do patient engagement to learn how to better use these tools, and think that there will be an opportunity to then create more clarity from the FDA on how they can be used. If we go to the next slide, you know, one of the really big parts of PDUFA is really ensuring that FDA has the resources that they need to hire and retain staff to help on all the initiatives that we're talking about. One particular area that we would like to see greater resources and some flexibility for FDA to hire folks would be on the point that Danielle made about more consistent communication with FDA and industry, and in particular, really along the lines of those that are developing their patient engagement strategies. Under the current system, you know, in most cases, industry has one meeting that they get before they submit their applications that they have to capture a whole host of issues to make sure that they and FDA are on the same page. And their patient engagement plan has to, out of necessity, become a small part of that. We would like to see a lot more frequent and robust communications and conversations between the agency and sponsors to ensure that their patient engagement plans are going to be something that are going to lead to information that's going to be usable by FDA. One of my greatest fears, although we have a lot of hope with PFDD, one of my greatest fears is that we'll see Certain companies devote a lot of resources to their PFDD efforts. They submit the information to FDA. It isn't used in any meaningful way because it's not quite what they were looking for. And then a lot of other companies get wind and say, okay, is this really worth the time and effort and money to do this? So we really think, particularly as the science is evolving, that we need to make sure that we get this right. I think one of the better ways to do that is ensure that FDA has the staff and expertise to be able to have frequent communications with industry. If we go to the next slide. So one other thing, area we like to see, and this kind of relates to, I know, a lot of work that Annie has done in her previous and current role on the Statement of Patient Experience, which is a template that industry sponsors, that the reviewers will say how and whether they used patient experience data that was submitted by the agency. One thing that's happening right now is that FDA is rolling out a knowledge management system, which is a computer system that essentially allows reviewers to tap into prior review decisions to see how the FDA previously incorporated information. We really want to make sure that the patient experience data is incorporated into this. So if a reviewer is trying to look to see how they should handle any patient information that's been submitted, they can pull previous decisions to see how that was done, and will really create some efficiencies and ensure that the patient perspective is included in their decisions. If we go to the next slide, we talked a little bit about real-world evidence. We've seen a lot of work move in that direction over the previous PDUFA iterations. One thing we like to see is that work continue and really want to see this done in a way that involves the patient perspective and the deployment. We think, again, some sort of pilot program that would include patient engagement in RWE design would be incredibly helpful. Go to the next slide. So last but certainly not least, one area that we've been really focusing a lot on are on core outcome sets. If we go to the next slide, and I will not walk us through this entire busy slide, but tune in next week. Mark will be kind of walking through it a little bit more. So core outcome sets are sets of measures that a whole host of stakeholders can use. What we currently see is really a lot of these kind of done today. They can be done in silos. We have seen areas where they're done in more of a collaborative consortia-like activities. FDA is actually currently funding a few areas for multi-stakeholders to collaborate and decide what are the outcomes that matter to patients that can be included in core outcome sets. One thing we would really like to see in an expansion of this is really taking an earlier, closer look at what are the evidentiary needs from a variety of stakeholders. So a lot of these outcomes that matter to patients, such as their impact on symptoms, their physical status, mental status, et cetera, really are consistent across the board in terms of how they impact patients and how they should be used in the health ecosystem. So we think that any sort of pilot program should ensure that we're really thinking across the pipeline on this and bringing in some of those folks who need this information as well. So when you think about payers, value assessors, a lot of these groups that need evidence to do their work, and for any of you that have participated in a value assessment, you know that it can be a lot of work to try to help collect some of that data. Our thinking is that these things should be done much earlier on in the process. So if at the very front end of research, we're thinking about what are the outcomes that matter to patients and how can that evidence be collected in a way that will be useful across multiple uses, we think we'll create some efficiency and really relieve a lot of the burden on patients.